love this intro. I know you hate it.
Yeah,
I love
it. It's not my thing, but...
Ah, it's really good. Top left, the Terran player for the Fnatic team. Don't ask for sunshine, this is...
Fnatic late call!
Such a hard...
Street Fighter feel voice is refusing.
Yeah, he gave up on
that. He's like, no, the real Rain is Protoss, and he doesn't play for Fnatic. I'm not gonna say his name.
Well, his opponent, of course, down here in the blue, he's already taken out two Fnatic players. If he beats this one, he'll have three fits. He is...
Beyond Prime!
We finally know which race Street Fighter voice plays.
Yeah.
He's a Protoss. I always knew it. So disappointing.
Well, you know, let's talk about Rain. He's actually one of the most annoying opponents to face coming into a best of one because... You talked about this earlier. He can be cheesy, he can play early, but if you let him go late game, he's one of the hardest players to kill. If you look up what late game TVT is and you see point defense drones and all these Vikings shooting at each other and battle cruisers, that is what you may face if you go late game versus Rain. He will mech you and then he will go into battle cruisers and you don't want to fight that.
Yeah, and guess who's going for the gas first?
Yeah,
it's Rain.
It's going to be Rain, man.
Yeah, and well, Gyan has shown us that he is awesome against Zerg.
Yeah.
Not just in general, but especially today, taking down Jay, taking down Moon. Now is up against a Terran player, and Rain is able to get into his base.
He could have blocked him out, but he decided not to. That's really interesting to me. But as we do have a gas first, it's impossible for him to stop the SCV from seeing that.
Oh, did he build it first? I thought he built it second.
I think it was gas first. No, actually it was not. My mistake. My mistake, guys. When you said gas first earlier, I thought... Gas first?
No,
you took it before, first as in he was the first player to take it. Okay.
Yeah.
I was like, you told me Kalder was gas first. I trusted you.
I trusted you. Okay, how did that end up being my fault? I don't know how you did it, but well played, sir. Well played.
I always thought I could rely on you for gas timings, even though I don't know what the previous
How did I end up defending myself right now? Something's wrong here.
We're going to have a Reactor Expand coming out from Rain, though, which is not too common in this matchup. Even less common, though, is a 1 Rax Expand into Triple Barracks in TVT. Byun is playing this very aggressive.
Yeah, and aggression is one of the things that really won him a few games already today. And as mentioned, he wants to go for the oil kill. This is something that Gerard mentioned in the interview, that he thinks Byun could get away with 5 kills today, which would, of course, also improve his standings in the individual ranking, which is still something that we should talk about. One of the things that did not happen was that Yonghua didn't get more wins the last time. Aya was actually all killed. Therefore, Yonghua is still leading the standings with a 10-1.
Yes. Yonghua is... He's just... It was so interesting to see LGIM play last time. That was a real treat.
Yeah, wasn't it? It was a little bit weird sometimes, some of the choices. I have to actually say that Yoda, with how he played in the group yesterday, played really impressive, but I still feel that in the GSTL match against Protoss, they should have tried to rely on Happy instead of Yoda. Both of them great Terran players, but I just feel that in this matchup, Happy would have been the better choice.
Yeah, absolutely. Yoda did, spoiler alert, Yoda did get out of his Code S group and took it, but that was a group where Rain did not attend, so it was a little bit special.
I can actually just see, you know, someone didn't watch Code S yet, and you're going for spoiler alert, and they jump up from their couch, run towards the TV, try to hit the mute button, and then you're like, oh, by the way, spoiler alert, yesterday he got out, and they're like, no!
Three people probably died trying to get out of their windows because of me, but you can talk to my legal team about that.
Your legal team. Dad! That's this guy, he says he's gonna sue me!
Well, if anyone jumped out of their window because of me, I hope you landed safely. And that you also didn't hear the spoiler that I said. Don't freak out, I'm not gonna spoil anything else. This attack that we're seeing from Rain would be great if there was no bunker, but the problem is there just simply is.
Yeah.
And it's kind of a funny way of moving out with just that small group of units, but if there's a medevac, it becomes so scary, but without the medevac, you can't get in the main base, and so the bunker alone is enough for Byun to feel like, ah, I'm okay here, I'm fine. Oh, and the Raven has been made. You know what that means. We're gonna see mech. We're gonna see a late game Rain. It's gonna be so hard to kill him.
It would have really surprised me if Bjorn would go for some kind of mech play here. With the bio aggression that he's shown in the last few games, he seemed really, really confident with it, and so he should. He's going for the plus one attack upgrade right now. Adds his starport a lot earlier in this matchup. A great scan here dropped by Rain. He sees everything that's going on. He has a great view on the tech of his opponent. And I'm really interested to see how well Rain does with this build here, with this mech.
Yeah. I'm really curious myself. This is a really good map for mech. We've seen so many players go for mech on this map, not only in this matchup, but also in the matchup against Zerg as well. But, you know, he is switching out off that starport, so he's just going to be making the Raven. He's using the starport as his add-on maker right now. He's now gone up to 3 factories. Bjorn, as far as I know, I don't believe he actually knows about this. He does not. And he's going to try to hit, it looks like, a timing with just plus one, with the extra barracks he added earlier. He wants to just stim and run in there and do damage. We've seen a lot of Prime players do this. We've seen Maru do this in the past, even though he likes to mech. We've also seen Marine King do this. This is a very Prime TVT build.
And, well, on the other hand, we have now the third base for Rain, who drops a command center at the top right. And with the style of play that he uses, well, he lands the command center. With the style of play that he uses, he's now in a position where he can definitely control the movements of Bjorn. At least for now. And Bjorn is eager to get his third as well. He's already starting to destroy the rocks. We have him now with Stim nearly finished, where of course Rain is trying to wait for the blue flame upgrade to make his Hellions even more effective against the Marines. And this is exactly the battle that we are going to have, but without blue flame, these Hellions need to be really careful.
Yeah, this is not going to be a fight that he wants to take straight up. Or am I wrong?
Well, now he has a lot more Hellions. The reinforcement just came in, and therefore the situation changes a little bit.
He didn't have very many Marauders, in fact, in that force. That was actually quite interesting to watch. You know, if the Hellions line up, they do a lot. They do a lot of splash damage, and he came from 2 angles even.
Yeah, he waited for the rest of the Hellions, and that's exactly what he needed to do. At first, when Bjorn moved down the ramp, there were only 6 of them available, but he pushed them back, and then Rain coming in from 2 angles. As you described, we had him just with a much better position against the Marines.
No medevacs really in that force either. There were only 2 on the map.
There's still 14 of them.
There's a lot of Hellions there, and since he destroyed those rocks, there's an easy way for the Hellions to bounce between bases. He's got to be very careful. And, you know, even with Stim here, he's got to bring the Marauders up to fight this, or he's going to lose more Marines. Really nice micro by Rain. And he's getting further and further ahead. He's had his third up for so long. He's building arguably the better composition. The one thing he's going to be lacking in, of course, is upgrades. That's why he's getting the double armory.
He forces quite a lot of Stims here, too. These medivacs are just not able to heal the hit points on the Marines and Marauders. There are only 2 of them. So this is really going to work in favor of Rain quite a bit.
Those Marines are the only Marines on the map for Rain. He's going mech. The Marines are actually they're the lesser tier units. He forces them to kill the rocks. Now the rest of the mech army helps out.
Regarding the Harvest account, we have a bit of a lead for the Prime player, 68 against 61. Another command center being dropped for Bjorn, who's now moving out and trying to make use of his more mobile army. But Rain plays a really interesting game here. Resources losses, by the way, 1,100 for both of them. Spot on.
You know, Rain has this Viking force that he's building up in the background. And this is what he's known for in the late game, is to have that Viking. He's got his Viking spread around the left side of the map to spot drops. He's got a force on the right side. He's got the watchtowers.
And he's getting a lot of missile turrets to make sure that draw play is not becoming an issue. He knows, of course, that if you play mech against bio, one of the things that you have to really be careful about is draw play and just your opponent getting into a better position because he's more mobile.
Exactly.
So him getting missile turrets is just so smart. Of course, there it is, the sensor turret. I was just about to mention it, that would be a great way of him detecting what's going on here. And Rain delivers right away, sensor turret being built.
Well, this is a bit of an awkward siege tank, but he blocks the choke point. And as a result, the Hellions actually do a few of them get taken out, and he surrounds them on the other side. This is a good little win here for Bjorn, because now he's got the army to where he can actually punch holes in anywhere he finds. If there are no siege tanks, he will be able to just run through that with his army. He's got his own siege tanks in the mix now as well.
That was a pretty awesome move. Rain getting a bit too greedy, he realizes, hey, I can take down this tank if I move in again. And he does, and this is exactly the small window of opportunity that Bjorn needs to walk in, to cut off his retreat, and then just flank him. Really well done, takes down all the Hellions.
The way he put that tank, it almost looked intentional. I wonder if you put the tank on the choke point like that to block it. That would be really interesting. It fits just perfectly there. There's a lot of siege tanks here, but remember, so much of the army supply for Rain is in those Vikings, which are not going to be good in a straight-up fight. These two Hellions could change the game quite drastically. There's nothing to defend. He's going to split the SCVs.
He's losing mining time already, and these Hellions are doing an excellent job here, taking down SCVs, making sure that the mining is reduced, and they force Bjorn back. Bjorn is taking a fifth and a fourth base.
Yes.
Moving in with the rest of his bio army and now, of course, dropping the mules here, but that was really well worth it.
He cancelled a barracks to build another command center.
He killed 10 workers with this move.
Yeah, and he lost a lot of mine time, but most importantly, as you said earlier, he forced Bjorn to turn around. He had this window of opportunity where maybe he could have punched through those siege tanks. He had a large bio force, but it wasn't 2-2 yet, and he just decided not to.
Rain was just supply blocked really like heavily, and then he dropped immediately 5 supply depots because he's like, that shouldn't have happened, but yeah.
Yep. Well.
And it's not going to happen again. He's on 200 supply, max supply now.
The situation that now Bjorn finds himself is he's maxed, but he can't fight. He can't take a fight. He's trying to figure it out, but with all of the defenses that we've seen set up here, it's just so hard. Look at that. 3 turrets are going to be erected soon. And this is a good place to fight, though. He cuts part of the army off, and this is exactly what Bjorn needs. He's going to catch some siege tanks here.
A fantastic job by Bjorn. Perfect timing.
I can't believe he didn't make use of his second army, though. Had he used his second army, he could have gone to the left as well. He might even find himself in the natural right now, but he hesitated too much. He didn't take that opportunity.
But still, he's building up a bank now. He's already at 200 supply. He's getting +3, +3. He's even in a position where he can take down the first few missile turrets on Icon.
Exactly, and he's going to do just that. He's dropping, and he will lose one medevac, but that is fine with him. The Vikings come back, but they're a bit too late. He needs to micro these units, though.
Yeah, he takes down the siege tank, and he's in an awesome spot here. Oh, 2 tanks pop out, and he can kill them right away.
Yeah, PDD is helping out quite a bit. He does not target the siege tanks, but now that the army's moved back, he finds the opening. This is exactly what you do with a mobile force with bio versus mech. He can fight these Hellions with tanks and marauders. He's going to feel fine against that. He needs the tanks to siege up, but he's not doing it. Now he does.
The tanks are sieged up, but the rest of the bio force is doing quite a bit of damage. But Fnatic, Rain is coming out a lot better of this scenario than I thought he would. With the drop in the main base, that looked for a moment really, really scary. He's still okay here, but we have the prime player in elite.
Yeah, he's got a great economic position as well. He's cut his opponent off.
He has 5 base against 3 now.
Yeah.
Rain is really struggling to establish his fourth, isn't he?
Yeah, he just really can't get in there. He's trying it again. That's why these units are waiting here. And he's going to even send a second squad in. And if he catches these tanks on siege, he will love to trade every single unit he has for those tanks because he knows his economy is better. He targets down the siege tanks one by one and will even get some of these Hellions. That was a great trade. He can even get one more tank he doesn't target.
Yeah, he didn't see it, but you're right. He killed way too many tanks for Rain to be comfortable in this spot. And now he takes a 40 supply lead. We have the +3, +3 upgrades for Bjorn nearly completed. The attack upgrade will finish any second.
He scans. He's just going to drop on these tanks.
And he can. There are no missile turrets.
Yep. Yet. The turrets are trying to come in here, but he can't quite get them up yet. This is exactly what you want to do with bio. He's doing it perfectly here. He rips through the siege tank line. He's going to get those turrets, and those Vikings are looking a little bit uncomfortable right now. They're just not useful in any way.
He's going to snipe this command center.
He certainly may. It's so close. At the very least, with the siege tank here, he's going to force a repair.
But I feel he could have...
I think you're right, but...
Maybe another stim and then focus with all the bio units, but even without it...
He's trying to find another angle here, but a great defense so far set up by Rain. He can't get into the main that way. He's got to find another opening. Again, the Vikings come through. They are keeping the medevacs off the map, but...
Oh, wow, he actually commits on 2 sides
now. He's going to flank, and he's going to get every single one of these siege tanks.
He's moving in and he's killing all of them, you're so right. 135 supply now against 173. The reinforcements streaming down the ramp right into the army of the prime player. But the reinforcements for him are ready. He's just rallying units across the map and he will definitely have the better bank to just completely sustain this aggression.
Exactly. He doesn't have a lot of medevacs because of those Vikings, but that's not what he needs right now. He just needs the sheer firepower. Splits his units again. Finally, the Vikings land, and this may actually be the nail in the coffin. He's losing every advantage that he had early on. He's got a base now, but he's got no army.
2-2 upgrades for the mech army of Fnatic Rain. GG.
What beautiful play. Beautiful play from Bjorn. Yeah. Taking him apart. He has dismantled now three players just with great multitasking, decision-making, his map awareness, you know, setting up traps for Lings, for example, setting up traps for those Hellions. He doesn't care how fast your unit moves, he's going to find it, he's going to kill it.
He's moving up the individual ranking fast. Three wins already. Fnatic a little bit at a loss here. They don't know what to do. They have to come up with another player. There is a life on the bench, and we have Bjal. One of the two of them has to step it up right now.
Yeah. I think now is time for Alive.
Yeah, me too.
Alive and then Bjal. That's got to be the order.
I feel Alive is... Is Bjal going to be the last player?
Well, I mean, it's either Alive or it's Bjal, you know? They only have two players left. That's the problem with Fnatic today is they've got a tiny lineup.
You know, we still have Antigua in the map pool. I would not blame Fnatic for picking Alive and setting him up against Bjal on Antigua. Trying to get rid of Antigua and playing the TBT match. But it's tough. No matter what they do, being down 3 points already, down to two players.
It's really tough. You know, talking to you about this even before the match, I said I would not be surprised if Bjorn gets the all kill. This team is not looking very strong right now. Bjorn is such a good player, and I still feel that way. I think he's going to do it. It's going to be so hard. They have to find out a weakness right now. He's just not showing any weaknesses. He's just putting them on the defensive. No matter how many turrets you have, no matter how many Santa towers you make, no matter how many siege tanks you have, he doesn't care.
I feel the best chance would be Bjal on a map that is good for Zerg against Terran. And it is Bjal. They're using him. I like this choice. I like it a lot. And I feel if one player today can take down Bjorn, it's going to be Bjal. With a good map, he can definitely pull it off. We have a lot of maps left. We even have Abyssal City left, a map where Zerg has quite a few advantages. The third base is quite exposed, so that might be the map that we are going to see next. But before we are jumping into the fourth game of the day, of course, we are going to have another short break here at the GSDL. We'll be back in 5 with Fnatic against Prime.